This is an hypothetical depiction of the entire process of machine learning modeling. So here is where we deal with the data. So we can call this one, these are the pre-processing stage. The pre-processing stage. See, it can be as simple as preparing the data. It was in text file, I need to put them in Excel file. I need to gather them from two sources. Sometimes you want to do modeling for your field, maybe like engineering fields. The data set is always very few. Usually you can go to different publications. I have seen somebody who did that. He went to different publications. He got like 10 samples here. He then put it in Excel. He got another 10 samples from another paper. That was how he collected all the data. In that case, this falls under pre-processing. So you are trying to get the data prepared. So once you get the data prepared, then how many stuff do I have? Sometimes you have to do what we call feature engineering. Feature engineering is a very big concept. So under it, we are going to talk about a subset of it, which we call the feature selection. Feature selection. Feature selection is very simple compared to feature engineering. Feature engineering is a very big concept that it involves even generating new features, features that are not part of what you have been given. Can we generate it? Manipulating and so forth. But feature selection is the common one, the commonest one that we do regularly. We're going to discuss that one later. So once you do data preprocessing, then you move to modeling. This is the one as we are the real processing starts. The real process starts there. Every year we can call it pre-processing before the actual processing actually starts. And once you do the data modeling, which is training and testing, then you have to check the performance. You have to calculate the performance of the model, which we mentioned earlier also. So if the performance is okay, then you can stop. But sometimes the performance is not okay for you. We don't discuss underfitting, overfitting. So the performance looks a little bit poor. Maybe you suspected underfitting or you suspected overfitting. So, okay, you might have to go back to the modeling. There's a tikrar here, there's a looping. You go back. Machine learning is an iterative process. I want us to also take note of this. It's not a process that you just get it right at the first time. It doesn't work that way. Rarely, you get it. Rarely do you get such a model, very rare, that you just plug in your data and everything is fine as you want. I just mentioned before the beginning of this new topic, pre-processing, that no algorithm is inherently better. No algorithm is inherently better. People face this challenge. When somebody makes a proposal, and sometimes you struggle to correct some colleague, that look, when the student makes a proposal for machine learning, you want him or her to mention that I'm going to use SVM. I'm going to use SVM and ANN in the proposal. I usually recommend let the student be very flexible here. Don't do the literature survey. Then don't put yourself too rigid. What if SVM and ANN doesn't work for the data? You are just collecting the data. The data is not yet ready. And in machine learning, you cannot guarantee that a particular model is going to work for you. So that is why once you check the performance, you might have to go back here, which is data modeling. Go and do the training and testing again by changing the parameter of the model or by changing the algorithm itself. Initially, it was ANN, neural network. Change it to K nearest neighbor. If it's not working, okay, change it to support vector machine. Keep checking until you see the one that worked for you. Yeah, it's one of the challenges in machine learning. You cannot just be sure from the beginning which method is going to work for you. So it needs trial and error. Check this out. Then you see, okay, this one. Although there are some that are very stable, considerably well, that if you use them in 10 places, maybe 8 out of the 10, they will be good. They'll get good results. So you can always zero in on them if you are in a hurry to get something done. But that doesn't tell you that you now say that, oh, the best machine learning algorithm is SVM. No. By the way, anybody that just said the best machine learning algorithm is so-so algorithm, he doesn't understand the way machine learning works. That is the summary we can say about such person. So indeed, there is no one to judge. Sometimes the performance is not good. You have to go back to feature engineering. Maybe you are using 20 features. Do we need to make it 23? Maybe you are using 20 features. Do we make you need to make it 7 or 5, lesser in number? Because sometimes lesser could actually produce better result. How we are going to get back to that? Inshallah. However, if performance is not good, we might have to go back to the one we're talking about, the pre-processing stage, whereby we want to look at the data preparation. Maybe the data is clean or it's not clean. Now, we keep doing this repetition until everything is done. And that's why you need experience of people. Imagine you have to do repetition in everything. How do you think? If you consult an expert, he might be able to tell you by looking at your data, looking at the statistical analysis of your data, he'll be able to advise you, okay, first of all, do this. Try to clean your data before you start changing the algorithm. Otherwise, you might end up changing 10 algorithms and you didn't get any good results. And finally, you now realize that the problem is in the data. This is why sometimes data preprocessing might be necessary. And there are major things we do in data preprocessing. The first one is called the missing data treatment. Sometimes the data is missing. It's part of the preprocessor. If you have your data and you have missing portion, you have to treat them. You see, you have to find out, okay, what is the missing data? Physically, you can see them there, that they are not in the system, in your data. You see one column is having some data that are missing. So why would data be missing? Maybe from the source. Something just went wrong. The information was not needed at that point in time, or the person entering it forgot to enter it. So why is it necessary for us to carry out missing value treatment? Because a single missing value can alter the performance of your algorithm considerably. So we cannot ignore it. So what are the different ways for treating missing data and treatment? So in summary, major ways, what are the methods for treating missing value? One, if you want to treat missing value, the best way to treat missing value is to go back to the source. Go back to the source. See, you go back to the where you got the data and tell them, please, can you give me this data that I missed? You fill it with the original data. But in most cases, we cannot use this method because the data say you don't even know who produced the data. Or even the company is the one that produced it. They say, oh, the people who work on it, they already retired long time ago. So we cannot get it for you. Then the next thing is to look at the attributes that has the most missing value. Because usually you have X1, X2, X3, X4, and then you have the Y, which is the final target. And then you have values here. So if this one have the maximum missing value, so many values are missing here, then you might have to delete this particular variable. Delete it, cross it out. This one also has so much missing value, cross it out. And there's a special formula to calculate when to know when to cross out a particular variable. However, there are situations whereby this is deletion, delete. The other one is to replace, you replace. So imagine I have only just 3 attributes. The idea of deleting one with missing value is not even there. So I'll have to leave everything intact, but rather I will replace them with either mean, median, or mode. So I'll look at this. Okay, there's a missing value here. There's another one missing. I'll calculate the mean of this data, of this attribute, the one that are not missing. What are the mean of them, the average? I'll use the average value, maybe it's 20.5. I'll use that 20.5 to replace all the missing values. This is how we treat missing values. It can also be mode, it can be median, depending on the type of data set. This is one of the major activities we carry out during pre-processing. Another very important thing that we carry out during pre-processing is known as outlier detection. Outlier detection, again, there is a complete video on detailed method of outlier detection and how we use them. What is outlier? Outlier is more challenging compared to missing value. Why? Because in missing value, you can see that something is missing. But in outlier, the data is there, but the data is just not good. It's going to confuse your algorithm. So you need to get them out. Ashar, what am I talking about? Let's say I'm modeling the student in a class, the age of my student. There's an attribute with the age of student. Another attribute with their weight. It's an undergraduate. So I have 20, 24, 25, 26, 1, 27, 20, 26, 25. These are the ages. Suddenly I got 127. Yeah. What is happening? You see? It's very challenging. Is it 127? Meanwhile, here it could be weight. You ask, we have 127 here. We have 126. You have 140. You have 80 kg. You have 90 kg. The same 127 is here. The same 127 is here. But here we want to declare it as an outlier. It's an abnormality. But here it is a normal value. So that is why it's very challenging for you to locate an outlier. Very, very challenging. You need to watch that video so that you can understand some of the examples we gave there. So, but when I look at the age, and imagine if I have 1 million data samples, 1 million records, how am I going to look at age, all of them one by one, to know that what is 127? No, we don't do that. We use an instrument like box plots in statistics. When you use box plots, we arrange the data in a graphical manner. So all the data, you see the distribution of the data, you will see the guy here, he will be the only one here, separated totally from them. Then you know that, oh, there's a data that is not like other data set. Practically plotting them on number line and try to see how many of them are far away from the other numbers. This is how we are able to locate outlier. And it is more challenging because the same value that is an outlier, it might not be outlier for another attribute. That is why you cannot just now search for 127 and say, okay, I need to replace in all the variables. No, it doesn't work that way. An outlier in one variable might not be an outlier in another variable, just like this example is indicating. And that is why outlier detection or treatment is more challenging compared to missing value. When we see missing value, we know there's a missing value. So once we're able to identify outlier, treatment is the same as the missing value treatment. You give the same missing value treatment that I already explained, which is number one, you go back to the source of the data, check it out. Two, try to delete that attribute that is having the missing value. Sometimes also you might have to delete the sample. Sorry, I didn't mention that. The sample that is giving you problem, maybe this sample has a missing value here, another missing value here. Out of four attributes, it has value for only one attribute. That kind of sample is a troublesome sample. We kick it out. We can delete sample also under deletion. So we use both for missing value and for outlier replacement also. The same way also we can replace our outlier with mean and median. We calculate the average of the ages here. We will not include this 127 because it's going to affect our average. Then we use that average to replace the 127 that is an outlier in the age category. Because I was sure that there cannot be 127 years old student in my class. And perhaps why they were entering the data is supposed to be 27, but the data entry clerk mistakenly enter one before typing 27 unknowingly. These are due to human error. It happens regularly. If we don't fix this kind of outlier, you'll be surprised, even the best of attributes, because just calculate the mean together with 127, it will change the mean to maybe something like 40-something. which is distorting our data. And that is why it's going to affect the modeling. Even the very powerful algorithm might not be able to get good results. So this is another very important thing that we do in pre-processing stage. Now, another thing that is very important we do in this data pre-processing stage is what we call data transformation. Data transformation sometimes can help us to avoid the problem of outlier. See, once we transform the data, it could make the outlier effect to be very low. Because like the example I just gave, everybody in the class is between age of 20 and 29. And somehow somebody is 127. If you go ahead with the modeling, your algorithm will be struggling to understand 127. Meanwhile, it's supposed to focus on this. Just imagine at the normal line, you are trying to memorize from 20 to 26 to understand the pattern. It's very easy for you to do, but the guy here, 127, is going to make you to waste a lot of time. You don't need to go through this place. You see, it's like going, you are asked to understand between 20 and 26 miles or kilometers. It's easy for you to cover it easily as an engineer supervising that area. Maybe there's a road construction going on. But now they ask you to supervise up to 127 kilometers just because of one guy here. So that is why in my head, I'm wasting a lot of your time because AI, you have nothing doing, and then you have to cover those distance. This is why outlier is very challenging, and we need to kick them out. But then sometimes because locating outlier is more difficult compared to treating them. So what do? We can use data transformation to reduce the effect of outlier. This is one reason why we use normalized data transformation is used for another purpose entirely, but we can use it to also treat outlier. How do we do that? We use this method called normalization. There are different data transformation schemes, but this is a very, very popular one. Normalization. What is normalization? This is where you convert your data from a present form to a low value equivalent. Let's say I'm having like this 127 as an example. I convert it to, I transform it, or I just normalize it. I want every data to be between 0 and 1. In that case, you will not even notice the outlier anymore. It reduces the effect of the outlier, even though originally it's not the essence. The main importance of normalization is if you have age, you have distance. Distance is in kilometer. Okay? Then you have weight. Yeah. Weight, this weight weight is in kilogram, the standard unit, but the distance is in meters. Distance is in meters. They take this way. This is another attribute. So when you have attributes in a particular data, they are not in the same unit. The measuring unit is totally different. So here you're having like 1 million kilometers, 9 million meters. Meanwhile, weight here is already in kilogram. If I convert it also to gram, it's going to be a huge number, but it's in kilogram, so it's going to be in few values. Maybe maximum is 127 kilogram, 45 kilogram. If you convert it to gram, you know it's going to be big value. But sometimes they don't even tell us the unit of this value. You just see that one value is small, one is big. Why are these differences? We use normalization to remove that effect of the differences in the value between different attributes. That is why we have normalization. That was the original essence of normalization. But along the way, when you use normalization, if there is any outlier there, it's like a byproduct of normalization. Normalization will reduce the effect of the outlier in case you are not able to locate it before the processing. Now, this is an example. We have different type of normalization. This is min max normalization. So you have the new value. You want to convert your data to new value. So this is an example. Let income range be 12 to 98. This is the minimum income. This is the maximum income. We have to normalize this to between 0 and 1. It means all the values should fall between 0 and 1, no matter how big value you have. So in that case, I want to convert this $73,000 to between 0 and 1. So use this formula. The formula is saying V is what I want to convert, the one I want to convert. V minus the minimum. This is 600. 73,600. V is the one I want to convert, which is 73,600, minus the minimum value, which is already given, divided by maximum minus minimum, multiplied by what is the interval given to you. It must be between 0 and 1. So you put it there. Formula is saying new maximum, the maximum is 1 minus minimum, which is 0, plus the new minimum. New minimum is 0. So we're going to get this value. So imagine 73,600 is being converted to 0.716. So all the data in that particular column will fall into the same range. And you do it for every column. You see? Because you have the minimum, you have to use minimum for this, minimum for this, minimum for each of them. So by the time you finish with the computation, every value in your data set will be maximum or between minimum of 0, maximum of 1. So which means on the number line, if you plot them, all the data will be together between 0 and 1. Nobody will be like 127 now. 127 will fall in line. This is why I said sometimes the problem of outlier could be resolved by normalization. Even though the essence of normalization was to avoid the effect of having different units, especially engineering areas, where your data set are coming from different attributes with different measuring devices. So those devices are calibrated in different ways. So their values are coming out with very huge differences in value. This kind of differences in value can confuse the model. So what do? You normalize. Once you normalize, irrespective of the value, they all come down to the same level. And between, imagine you have distance between 0 and 1, you have weight between 0 and 1, age is between 0 and 1. Very fantastic. It makes it very easy. However, I usually encourage people, don't normalize your outputs. Let's pay attention to this. Don't normalize your outputs. Because some people want to normalize output. Yes, if your output also has very big values, maybe one is 20, another one is 260, another one is, why this jump? You can normalize them. But however, once you normalize your output, after the prediction, you have to convert it back to the original value. Because once you predict, you are predicting normalized value, not original value. So you have to convert the result from the prediction to the original value again, which is just opposite of this formula. You have to make this the subject of relation now. Our mathematician can do that for us. Make this the subject of relation. This V1 is already known. This is the new value you predicted now. This new prediction will be given. Now you now calculate the original value. That is just doing the ant normalization. That is if you normalize your target. Personally, I try to avoid normalizing targets. So because that will waste some time again to do the ant, and sometimes could be confusing. Some people will normalize. I've seen people who send paper out for revision, for review, and they normalize data, but they did not remember to convert it back to the original. So the output they were getting were very low. The error was very low, but the error was on the normalized value, which is not correct. So if you normalize your output, remember to take it back to the original value. But if you only normalize the attributes, then that is fine. You don't need to do any post-processing conversion. Then this is the Z-score normalization. It has its own formula, so which you can use to also convert your value. This one, you don't need to specify the interval where you want it to be, not between 0 and 1. This is min-max normalization. This one is Z-score. Just do the normalization. It will reduce it from 76 to 1.225. Normalized by decimal scaling also is also there, where you just divide it by 10 raised to the power j. That will bring all the values down naturally. This is the idea of preprocessing and some of the things we do there. Once your data is in very unique range, it makes it very easier for your algorithm to work fine, but not in all situations. Again, let the data speak. Always remember this policy, let the data speak. That is, it depends on your data. I've seen data that with normalization, the accuracy goes down. Without normalization, you get better results. Hajib, yeah, it happens sometimes. And that's why I recommend, once you pick your data, you go straight to do a initial or a quick modeling. See, open your processing system. Yeah. Yeah. Look, can you see my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, you can see.
Okay, thank you. Okay, this is the processing aspect of our Weka that we are using. This is the processing aspect. So once you open it, a lot of things can be done in the processing stage. So for the pre-processing, you can do several filter, you can correct it, you can use different filter. See, you can, it could be supervised filtering, it could be attribute based on supervised, depending on the kind of problem we are. You want, if at some time you want to try and add noise, you want to remove noise, convert, sometimes you have to convert data to numeric. Sometimes some data, they are not in number types. You want it to become numeric. Maybe you have male, female, M, F, M, F. You want them to become 1, 2, 1, 2. And these are all part of pre-processing that you can do. But however, the rule of thumb I give to people, if you don't have missing value, if you don't have noisy data, if it is just that maybe the value is big or not big, go ahead and do your modeling first. Do the modeling. Select training percentage, maybe 70%, and run your experiment. Are you getting good results? I got 99% accuracy for my testing. What else do you want? 99%, that is excellent. It means your data is doing fine. Don't waste your time on anything again. Except maybe, okay, maybe I need to reduce the number of features, then we can do that later. Oh, 99% accuracy, 97%, even 95, even 85. That means your data is doing fine originally. Because, you know, human beings, naturally, we want to get the best. So, okay, I want to do more. That's fine. They try to do normalization and see maybe you can take it to a higher level. But sometimes you see your normalization gave you lower results, just hands up, colors, and leave it like that. But you run your experiment for the first one, you got like 40% accuracy. And then you have to scratch your head and start thinking, wow, something is wrong somewhere. You don't condemn your algorithm. It might not be the fault of your algorithm. Maybe your data need to be normalized. You see, maybe the data need to be normalized. Or maybe you need to do, maybe there are some outlier there that you didn't manage. So it is the pre-processing aspect of Weka where we do some or all of this particular kind of pre-processing. So you want to remove some attributes. I can click an attribute here. And I say, okay, I can remove an attribute. I don't want this attribute. So I can remove it here. You can see I can remove this attribute. It's gone from my list. And I apply it. Once I apply it, so any data I'm using, other two attributes are gone. I want to also remove these attributes. I don't want them. So you remove them. Because I think maybe they are causing problem for me. If you want to bring them by, I have to undo. There's a button here to undo. You always undo whatever you do on the screen, under the pre-processing stage. So this is what we're going to have today. So regarding this, so inshallah, next week we move to our feature engineering or feature selection, which is also optional, but sometimes I become very much important in getting very better results. So once again, our apologies for the delay in starting the class. So if there's anybody that have questions, so we can ask our questions before we call it today.
Welcome to live, Prof.
Walaikum salam.
Jazakumullah khairan.
Yeah.
I have a question with regards to the normalization.
Okay.
Yeah, you said that sometimes maybe there is no need to Or rather, when we do normalization for the output that we need to reconvert back to the original value so that we can know whether the data is doing well, I mean, whether the algorithm is doing well or not. Now, the question is that you also said that when we normalize the X values, that we do not need to convert back to the original value. So why is it not necessary if for the predicted value, we need to go back to the original data? Why is it not necessary? Yeah. For the
it's clear. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. You know, we have our data. The data is like X1, X2, and then we have Y. This is the one we want to predict. What's your feed, the questioner? Engineering feed or medical feed? I mean, by profession, the questioner.
Engineering, sir.
Okay, let's say you are modeling which engineering?
Material science.
Okay, let's say you are modeling the strength of material. I want to know which example to use, okay? Let's say we are modeling the strength of material. We want to know the tensile strength of a bridge or a particular material we want to use. So why is that strength of material? We have some attribute that can help us to predict the strength of this material. So this is what we really need to calculate our accuracy or root mean square error. These guys are just input for us. Once I get my results, I don't need this guy again. This is the issue. Now, let's say here is 20, this is 25, this is 40, this is 42. Example, strength of material is 22.2, this one is 23.3. Just let's assume. Now, I notice I am here also, maybe this is 127. This one is 455. I can see some number. I said, okay, let me normalize. So I normalize this thing. Everything becomes 0 and 1, 0 and 1. Between 0 and 1, between 0 and 1. And then usually I don't do it for this guy. I let it be original. Because at the essence, we want to predict this value. This value is already on your system. You have the original data with you. You have the original data with you. So during training, we take this one in. Say, when you see this 20 and 25, the answer you should predict for me is 22.2 during training. After the training, we now use our model to predict new data. Maybe we have some new data, like we have like 1 up to 80 data. We'll use it for training. The other 20, which is number 81 to 200, we use them for testing set. So in the testing set, we give the input to the system, and then it will produce an output, which it doesn't know. Maybe now it produced 42. Now, we need to look at the original given to us is 40. The original given is 43.4, but our system is predicting 42.5, for example. This is our prediction for the testing set. Now you combine, we have to compare 43.4 minus 42.5. So in that case, you get the difference. This is the error. We call it error in prediction. This is the error in prediction. So 42.4 minus 42.5, that's going to give us like a mathematician. Somebody bail us out. That is 1 point something?
0.9.
Thank you very much.
0.9.
Thank you, Professor of Mathematics. Appreciate it. It's 0.9. So this is 0.9. This is the error for one sample. We have error for other samples. You have to do that for every sample. Then we're going to find the sum of these errors. We find the sum of this error. We say we have root mean squared error, the sum of all the error. Now, thank you very much. So we find some of the errors. Now, once we are done with that, the error we are finding, you can see, is from the original data, 43, 42. Now, imagine if you normalize this data, which I personally don't do. So these values will be gone. You are going to be calculating error for zero, between 0 and 1. Maybe this one will become 0.2. The other one will become 0.3, 0.5. So when we predict, our machine learning algorithm will be predicting something like, for this 43.2, it will not predict 43.2. It will be like maybe 0.75. Because everything is between 0 and 1. So now, it's between 0.75. So if we calculate the root mean square error based on this value, the root mean square error will be very, very low. Maybe here we are getting like 0.9 as the error, but here we might be getting 0.0001 because you are actually calculating error from the normalized data for the output, which is going to be different from what someone already published on in the journal that you are trying to compare your work. So the comparison will not be valid. So that is why after you have predicted the output, you need to convert that prediction back to the original value. Maybe 0.75 you predicted is like 43 point something, then you cannot find the error. As for X, these are values we are using for our modeling. We don't need those values again in calculating the output of our prediction. Like, okay, what is the root mean square error? What is the percentage of maybe correlation coefficient? We don't need X to calculate the, they are ingredients for us. This is our own guide that we really need to know the value. I'm not sure if it's clear now, doctor. It's okay. Okay, thank you. Any other question?
Yes. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Adam, for this.
You're welcome. Yeah.
I just want to ask regarding when you have a data point.
Yeah.
It's like 1,000 and it is divided into testing and validation.
Okay.
So after training, so which one will come first? Is it validation or testing?
Okay.
So after training, so I want to know. So can you go ahead with testing and then validate? Or validation has to come first before testing?
This is where we have it. We had it here. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes.
Yeah, so people, the most common one people does, especially because data are not always available in abundance, is to divide into two. Use it for training, use it for testing, and then you finish. It's fine, it's acceptable. But we have a couple of guys that will say, okay, why don't you have, it's not a big issue. But if you have three, it's all about name. Some people call it, okay, we have training sets, 50% or 70% as you want. They will say, we have testing set one. Some people call it this way to avoid confusion. Testing set one is 25%. They say testing set two. They say 25%. It doesn't matter. Okay? So what we are saying is when after training, I have a test set that I reserve. I use for first test, stage one testing. You can call it stage one test. After that, then we have another testing. We call it stage two testing. But however, because why I'm explaining this to you is, you might find in literature, people will call this second one validation test. Another literature, you will see people call this one validation test. Are you with me, doctor? So this is why I explain this. They are doing the same thing. It doesn't matter. You see?
Okay.
That is why, in case you read somewhere, but usually we say training, then you validate. We're trying to check what we have done in the training. Is it okay? Let's validate it. But finally, when we want to deploy for the client, for our customer that needs that particular application, we get more data from them or the one we reserved as part of the data sent to us, then we can use it as test set. But some people will decide to say, no, this is test set. This is the one to validate before I give it to my customer. So sometimes people use it interchangeably. It doesn't really matter. Just note the kind of data partition you have used. So that was also I mentioned some times ago. I said sometimes you have a client. Once the client gave you 1,000 data, even though you divide it into three, the professor does not trust you. He said, I gave you this data. That's why you are able to get good results. You will bring your laptop to my laboratory. I will give you a new data. And then you use it on that model you are claiming to be good. And then I will see what you are going to get. We have seen people who went to this extreme end. Even after you have used 1, 2, 3, the company still wants you to test with, we call it production data in software engineering. The data that is being produced now in their company, they want you to use your model to predict it, if it's going to work. We sent you 2,000 data, you claim it's working, but we want you to do it in our presence. So what do we call that kind of data? It's still going to be testing set or validation set. So we can have as many as possible just to gain the confidence of our client. That is the essence of validation test or publication test. But the commonest one is to call it, the first one is called validation set, and the second one is called testing set. But we don't, if you don't want to use three sets, then we call it training and testing. We kick out the validation. And that is why some people say, okay, if we are kicking out validation when you have only two, okay, the third one you are bringing in should be the one that should be called validation, because it's the one that is not there in the case of two sets. Are you getting my point, sir?
So yes, yes.
It doesn't really matter how we call it. Thank you very much for that.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay, so in the absence of no other questions, so thank you very much again. And inshallah, Khair, we're going to meet next week. And like I mentioned last time, even before we went for vacation of Ramadan, I strongly encourage us to practice. Machine learning is better learned by practicing. You need to practice, get a data set from your field, and try to practicalize some of these simple things. So, and I remember then I went online and I shared data repository with you. So this is a very, very popular data set. For those that are inclined to research, that you want to do research, I recommend it for you a lot, because the advantage of this data is they will not only give you the data, they will give you those papers that are already published using the same paper. So by so doing, you know who has worked on your paper. You can see this data, these are out in 2021. I click the number of year. If you click the year, I give you the oldest on top. You see, it giving me the oldest or the newest on top. So you can check it out. You see a lot of data there that relate to your area of interest. You have engineering data, so many ones are there. So once you detail whatever data you like, try to download the data and try to see how can you practice some of these simple things we have discussed. This is COVID-19 surveillance data. So if you like that, everybody is talking of COVID-19. Let's check COVID-19 data now. Even if you are not a medical doctor now, you are forced to think about COVID-19. So look at this COVID-19 data. This is what you are going to have. It will tell you the characteristics of the data. It is multivariate. Number of instances is 14. It means the number of instances is 14. Number of samples, too small. Number of attributes is 7. You see? What is this task? It is classification task. It's not a regression task. Missing value, no missing value. They give you the attributes. So, and then they will tell you relevant paper. They tell you somebody already used the data to publish. And it makes your life easy. So you just download this paper and try to see what they have done and now see what you can do to improve upon what they have done. This is why I usually recommend this. There is another one called Kaggle. So, Kaggle is also very popular, if you like that one. So, control T. So there you have Kaggle for you. Kaggle data set, see? Here you have a lot of data set, new data set. But the only challenge here is you have data set there, they don't tell you someone has used it before or not. It's one of the feedback I gave to them. There's need for you, at least let people update as they make use of the data, so that make it easy for researchers to follow up with what someone did before. That means you might be using a data set, someone is already work and publish, but you are not aware. But there's no way you can go into papers and see who has used this or not. So this is an advantage I personally found in this UCI over the other. Once you have read the basic thing, they'll tell you the attribute, they will explain the guidelines, then you can download the data set here. This is the folder for the data set. You can download it here, surveillance data. And then here you go. So let's try to get a particular problem area and try to practice some of these simple things we have discussed. You see, open Weka, load your data in, click it, do your initial modeling, because machine learning is better learned through practical application. So you get to know more as you try to model it. If you run into any trouble, we have a chat forum there. You always get across to us. Anybody in the forum can answer questions. And specifically, if you want me to answer questions, you can tag me or you can send them privately. Inshallah, I'll be available to assist, inshallah. So we don't just learn it and memorize and then we forget. But rather, let's start doing something, no matter how small. like my doctor who is in material engineering, bring a material application that you understand the way the data was, and then try to see how you can run your first model. And as you do that, then you get to understand it better. Question will be coming as you run it. So then, inshallah, we'll try to provide those solutions based on the life. So thank you all for attending the class, and I wish you all the best. May Allah bless the time. Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa alayhi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
That's my love.